We're looking at John Oakley McElhenney's Deep Space Divorce Saga. Not your typical space opera, though, it's actually a series of blog posts, where McElhenney uses this extended metaphor of space travel to dissect his own divorce.
Yeah, it's really fascinating how he takes something so painful and personal and reframes it as this epic journey, like using the vastness of space to gain some emotional distance, maybe even find some humor, without downplaying how hard it is.
Yeah, like picture this, you're in this rocket ship, right, representing a marriage, a family unit, and then bam, divorce hits. That ship is suddenly ripped apart. How do you even begin to navigate that? Yeah. The debris field of emotions, finances, the whole co-parenting thing. That's what this saga explores. We've got all 6 chapters laid out, and we're gonna see how McElhenney finds his way back to a sense of wholeness, or as he puts it, back to Earth.
And that journey back to Earth, it's not a straight shot, full of twists and turns, moments of doubt, even glimmers of hope for reconciliation. We'll see how honestly he portrays that complexity as we go through the chapters.
Definitely. In chapter 1, my little rocket ship of hope and love.
Yeah.
It starts with a line that just throws you right into this metaphor.
He says,
so I'm a little rocket ship. Talk about setting the scene.
Oh yeah, right from the start, you get this sense of optimism, like he's fueled up and ready for anything. But then divorce hits, and that map he had, it's literally ripped in half, that feeling of disorientation, of being completely lost. I think anyone who's been through a major life change can relate to that.
Absolutely. It really makes you think about what that torn map represents.
Mm.
Is it the loss of shared dreams, the future you thought you had?
Exactly. And then the chapter ends with this cliffhanger.
Yeah.
About gaining strength and insight. Makes you want to keep reading to see how he actually finds that amidst all the chaos.
For sure. Then in chapter 2, single parent moon landing. Into the sea of tranquility. I mean, the title alone is a bit of a paradox, right? A crash landing. But in a place known for peace.
It is. It's all about stripping everything down to the essentials. When you're suddenly facing this huge upheaval, you have to ask yourself, what really matters? What are my priorities now? And finding that stillness, that sea of tranquility, even amidst the chaos, is key to starting over.
Yeah, it's like he's forced to shed all the non-essentials, just like a lunar module shedding weight for landing.
Precisely. And in that shedding, that letting go, he finds a new perspective.
I like that. And then we come to chapter 3. The crew must survive. And the focus shifts to action. It's not just about processing the emotional fallout anymore. It's about figuring out how to move forward.
He talks about redrawing the map, acknowledging that the old plans, the old life, are gone.
And that new map isn't just for him, right? It's for his crew, his kids. It highlights that sense of responsibility of having to keep everyone on board safe, even when you're navigating uncharted territory.
Absolutely. And he uses this brilliant analogy of fuel production to represent financial stability. It's a reminder that practical matters are just as important as emotional ones in this process. You need that fuel to power the journey ahead.
Yeah, it's like he's saying, okay, the rocket ship might be damaged, but we need to make sure we can still reach our destination. Then in chapter 4, preparing to disembark, lift off from Tranquility Base, we see a real shift in tone.
Definitely. He goes from feeling numb, slightly anesthetized as he puts it, to being fully awake, ready to move on. He spent enough time on the moon, reflecting and regrouping, and now it's time for liftoff.
There's the sense of agency there, of taking control. He's not just surviving anymore. He's actively planning his return to Earth. But as we'll see, that journey back isn't always smooth sailing.
Right. There are doubts, setbacks, even moments where he questions whether he should abort the mission altogether. We see all of that in chapter 5. Massive action. The return journey begins now. And the final chapter, we almost lost the ship.
And that's where we'll pick up in our next deep dive. We're going to unpack chapter 1, We Almost Lost the Ship, and really get into the nitty-gritty of how McElhenney navigates those early turbulent days post-separation.
So we left off with this image of McElhenney as this little rocket ship, all set for blastoff, into a happy future. But then what happens when that rocket ship starts to malfunction? That's what we're diving into with chapter 1, We Almost Lost the Ship.
Yeah, he really doesn't shy away from how sudden and jarring that experience can be. He describes it as the map being ripped in half, the fuel supply being shut off. It's like everything you thought you knew about your life, your future, is suddenly just gone.
Yeah, it's that feeling of free fall, like losing all sense of direction. And I think what makes this chapter so powerful is that he doesn't sugarcoat it at all. He admits to floundering, feeling lost, confused.
Right. But even in that darkness, there's this glimmer of hope. He mentions gaining strength and insight from this whole experience. It's like he's already looking for the lessons, the ways to grow from this, even though he's still reeling from the shock.
It's that resilience, you know.
Yeah.
That determination to find meaning, even in the most painful situations. That really sets the tone for the rest of his journey. It's like he's saying, okay, this is bad, but I'm not going to let it break me. I'm going to learn from it.
Yeah, I love that. It's usually a terrifying thing, but it's happening in a place known for peace and serenity.
Right. It's a beautiful metaphor for what he's going through emotionally. He's been through this traumatic event, this forced separation from everything he knew, and he's landed in this desolate yet strangely calming landscape.
Makes you think about what that sea of tranquility represents for him, right? Is it a state of mind, a place of acceptance?
I think it's both. He's been stripped down to the essentials, forced to confront what truly matters in his life. He even says, it's not the things, it's not your house or your car, it's not even your own happiness.
Wow, there's a real sense of letting go in this chapter, of shedding the material and emotional baggage that's weighing him down. It's like he's saying, okay, I've lost a lot, but what can I build from here?
And that's the beauty of the moon landing metaphor. It's not just about survival. It's about starting anew, planting a flag in this unfamiliar territory, saying, this is where I begin again.
Powerful imagery. And that sense of new beginnings carries over into chapter 3, The Crew Must Survive. The focus shifts from personal reflection to action. He realizes he's not alone on this journey.
Yeah, he's got his crew, his children, who are depending on him, and that responsibility fuels his determination to find a way forward.
He talks about redrawing the map, which is such a powerful image. The old map, the old life, gone. He needs a new plan, a new direction.
And that new map isn't just about figuring out his own path. It's about creating a safe and stable environment for his kids. He's the captain of this ship now, and he needs to make sure everyone on board makes it through the storm.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And to do that, he needs fuel. He uses this analogy to talk about financial stability, which is such a crucial aspect of divorce, especially when kids are involved.
It's a reminder that rebuilding your life isn't just about emotional healing. It's about practical matters, too. You need a solid foundation to build upon.
Yeah, it's like you're saying, okay, we might be sliding through a debris field.
Yeah.
But we need to make sure we've got enough fuel to reach our destination. And that sense of purpose, of having a mission to accomplish, really drives him forward.
Definitely. It's a shift from feeling like a victim of circumstance to becoming the architect of his own future. And that's where we see him really start to take control. In chapter 4, preparing to disembark, lift off from Tranquility Base. He's no longer just surviving. He's actively planning his return to Earth.
There's a sense of urgency now, of needing to move on from that temporary base and continue the journey.
He's shed the weight of the past. He's refueled. And he's ready to launch himself back into the world. But as we'll see in the next two chapters, that journey back isn't always smooth sailing.
Oh, I'm sure there are going to be bumps along the way. Moments of doubt, even temptations to turn back.
Exactly.
But that's what makes this saga so relatable, so human.
It's not a fairy tale ending. It's a messy, complex journey of self-discovery. And we're going to see how he navigates those challenges in the final part of our deep dive.
Okay, so we left off with McElhenney, ready to launch himself back into the world after that moon landing period of reflection. And in chapter 5, massive action. The return journey begins now. You really feel that shift from contemplation to execution.
Oh yeah, definitely. There's a real sense of purpose there, determination in this chapter. He's done mourning the past, and he's ready to take control of his future. He even lays out a clear 3-part plan.
Oh, that's interesting, like a pilot running through a pre-flight checklist. What are those 3 key steps he needs to take to get back on course?
Well, first, he needs to secure his fuel source, which in this context represents financial stability. You know, divorce can be incredibly draining financially, so it's no surprise that this is a top priority for him.
Makes sense. Creating that solid foundation, that sense of security, so he can focus on rebuilding other aspects of his life. So what's next on the checklist?
Finding a new rocket ship, which symbolizes a new home, a fresh start. He's leaving behind the old vessel that represented his past marriage and creating a new space for himself and his children.
It's a powerful image, letting go of what was, embracing the unknown. But even with a plan, a full tank of fuel, space travel is rarely smooth sailing. Is that reflected in the final chapter?
Absolutely. Chapter 6, We Almost Lost the Ship, really reveals the vulnerability that lies beneath all that determination. Even with the plan in place, doubts and uncertainties creep in. He even admits to considering reconciliation.
Well, it's a reminder that divorce, isn't a linear process. There are going to be moments of doubt, second guessing, even a longing for what was lost. It makes the whole experience feel much more human and relatable.
And it's a testament to his honesty that he includes those moments of vulnerability in his narrative. He's not trying to present some sanitized version of divorce. He's showing the raw, messy reality of it.
Exactly. So we end this saga with McElhenney's ship, still a bit shaky, the future uncertain, but the fact that he's even attempting this journey, sharing his struggles and triumphs with such honesty, it's incredibly inspiring.
It really is. It's a reminder that even when life throws you off course, you have the strength to find your way back. You have the power to chart your own course, find your own fuel source and rocket ship, and ultimately create a new life for yourself.
Well said. And that's a wrap on our overview of the Deep Space Divorce Saga. We covered a lot of ground today, from that initial shock of separation to the challenges of rebuilding.
Hopefully you found some insights that resonate with your own journey, whatever that may look like.
Absolutely. In our next deep dive, we're going to unpack chapter one, We Almost Lost the Ship, and really delve into those early turbulent days post-separation. Join us then as we continue exploring the complexities of divorce and the power of using metaphor to make sense of life's biggest challenges. Thanks for listening.